everyone, welcome to Eurogamer. My name's Ian Higton, and today's live stream is a very special live stream. I'm playing a game called Lumo. Lumo was released just at the beginning of this week, or was it the end of last week? It's out now anyway, it's out on the PS4 and PC. It was recommended in our review. Simon Parkin called it enchanting. It is a game that really, really strikes a chord with me because, as you know, I'm quite old, even though I don't look it. I don't look a day over 21, but I'm quite old. I was back there in the ZX Spectrum days, and this game is full of nostalgia. This game is Lumo, and I'm very, very pleased to be joined today on the stream by Lumo's creator, Gareth Noyce. Hello, Gareth. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Hello. How are you doing?
I'm very good, Gareth. Very good. Absolute pleasure to have you on the stream as we play through 90 minutes worth of Lumo. You able to stick around for 90 minutes?
Absolutely.
Excellent. Absolutely. So first off, I think for people who don't know, I think you should probably introduce yourself. Let us know kind of your history in video games, where you've worked, what you've worked on, as I take a little tour around the opening level of Lumo.
Okay. So I started working in the games industry, I think 2002, 2003. Originally at a company called Climax, worked on Sudeki and Black Hawk Down and Game Boy game called Witch. And then started a kind of contracting firm, and we were sort of dropped in to do firefighting work on a bunch of projects. So got to work with some really good studios like Silicon Knights and Two Human and Bizarre for Project Gotham Racing. Stint on Fable 2 for Lionhead, and then Crackdown 1 with Real Time Worlds. And eventually our little band of contractors kind of formed Ruffian Games and did Crackdown 2, lots of Kinect games that I'm trying to forget so I don't really want to talk about. Before I kind of eventually went off and went solo. So that's kind of where we are today. I left Ruffian 2 years ago. I started Lumo pretty much immediately, and I've been working on it ever since.
Cool. So I've played through Lumo already. I've completed it. I was speaking to you about this on Twitter. I kind of see Lumo as almost like a bit of an autobiographical game for you. It seems to chart almost like your gaming history. Not just games you've made, of course, but games that have inspired you and been part of your life. This school, for instance, is a good... a very good example of this. What is this school all about? This is based on something.
Yeah, so before I actually was working in the industry commercially, I was kind of doing some open source stuff and wasn't really getting anywhere. I was applying to game studios but wasn't really getting much interest. And I went to an event called Retrovision, which was advertised in Need to Know, which was an old email circular for geeky Unix beards. And we turned up at Retrovision, and it was basically this kind of thing, but it was in a pub, but loads of people had set up old machines, and Jeff Minter and a few other game developers were there, and I'd been a massive fan of Jeff Minter's games ever since I was a kid. Just went up to him and was like, dude, can I buy you a pint? Because like, you're Jeff Minter. And eventually there was a few more of these events, and I got started to know more and more people, and it slowly led into me actually getting a job as a tester at Climax. Right. So there's a sort of circularity with Lumo, because it's an isometric game. The first game that I bought was Head Over Heels, which was also an isometric game. So I wanted, you know, it to kind of reflect those feelings I had as a kid, and the natural way to do that was kind of this school. It's meant to be, if you go to the entrance door, you can see the poster on the wall says Retrovision 2, and that was literally the poster for the second event. So I wanted to kind of, you know, have that circularity and kind of make it real in the game. You know, it was literally a reflection of my path into games. And for the player, you're going to go through the same thing. You're going to go to Retrovision and get sucked into games. So
awesome. We've got a couple of things on these monitors here. A couple of games loading screens. What are they? Are they?
Yeah. So the one on the left is Rex by Jazz Austin, which was a late Spectrum game, but it's a hard as nails platformer with like a kind of rhinoceros with a jetpack and a laser gun, which was awesome, technically stunning. And then Amaroot from the Pickford brothers. The bigger TV is a demo from a demo scene group called 8-Bit, and they worked with me at we worked at Climax together, and one of the guys worked on Crackdown 1. Now, they did Spectrum demos in the demo scene for a long time, for about 10 years. Yeah. And I was just like, dudes, you've got to let me have one of your demos for the intro. So they were like, yeah, sure, and you can take it. So if you actually stand and watch the whole demo, there's an achievement for it as well.
What's the demo called? Because you can,
it's called Pimp My Spectrum. Yeah.
You can actually watch it with sound and everything properly on YouTube. I searched for it. And it's on YouTube as well. But you get an achievement if you stand and watch.
Yeah, so the gap next to the guy that's watching it, if you just sit in that gap from the very start until the end, you'll get one of the hidden achievements is for watching.
Right. Well, I won't do that now. I should kick off the game. Oh, what have we got here? Have we got any, what's that? Uara Kung Fu.
Yeah, so
fighting farmers.
The arcades have got some vague relevance as well. So, Neutrino was the first game that me and my friends tried to make. Early 90s for the Acorn Archimedes. We never got anywhere, as you'd expect. I think we had like some D-paint drawings of the levels and some sprites and stuff.
Yeah.
But we never really finished it off. And then Balls Up was an iPhone game that I released in 2009. And then Uar Kung Fu was a paper design that I did for a fighting game based on Yi Ar Kung Fu, the super old 80s arcade. Incredible. And then obviously Llamatron, because, you know, Jeff Minter.
Yeah. Jeff Minter did TXK, is that right?
Yeah, he did, yeah.
And you did the sound, the music?
I did one of the sound. I did the ravey music that you hear early on. There was a bunch of people off of his forum did the rest of the music.
Cool. Well, we've just been scanned by the spec eye and we've gone all Tron. We have now inside the game, I guess.
Yeah.
This is where Lumo starts off proper. And you take the form of a little wizardy chap or chapess.
He's got no name. You don't know if it's a boy or a girl. He's, I just say he.
Yeah. He could be. I wasn't sure whether he was called Lumo or whether...
Lumo was because of the translation. I think the literal translation from Finnish to English is enchantment. And I wanted... That was kind of like the summation of the feeling that I wanted to get in the game. So that's where the name came from. Yeah. Originally, it was called Arse Over Tit as a play on Head Over Heels.
Amazing. I kind of like that.
I got voted out of it. There was a discussion in the house and my girlfriend won.
Sense wins over awesome titles, I guess.
Yeah, bad puns only.
But if you've played games like Head Over Heels or Solstice, things like that, you're going to recognise this setting, this isometric viewpoint. Each room in Lumo is kind of floating in space as you go through doors. It opens up new rooms, and a lot of these rooms have little Easter eggs in. Are there any Easter eggs in this little corridor room?
So the boxes are kind of an Easter egg. They have a mix. There's some with AC and G Limited on, and that's Ashby Computers and Graphics Limited. They're the company that eventually became Ultimate Play the Game. And then Ultimate Play the Game became Rare. So they started the whole thing off with their Filmation engine. I think Nightlaw was the first one, and then Attic Attack and Alienate and stuff. So really, that's a super nerdy reference. That's a proper Train Spotter reference.
That's the thing. Like I said, I've played through the game. I've completed it. And all the way through, I was spotting little Easter eggs that were making me smile, like little references to games I remembered. And I was like, oh, I know what that is. But then also, I'm guessing there's a load of really obscure stuff that I missed completely, like the AC and G Limited stuff. Before we go any further, by the way, I should say that I have been kindly given 10 codes for Lumo to give away. I've got 5 Steam codes and 5 PS4 codes to give away during this stream. What I'll be doing is I'll be dropping them every so often into the YouTube comments. So keep an eye out on the comments. I'll give you a little bit of warning when I'm going to drop one in. I'm going to drop a Steam code in now, in the next 30 seconds, so there's no delay. But if you've got Steam or you've got a PS4, get your... get the code entry screens open. It's fast as fingers first on these codes, but you are in with a chance of winning a copy of this game if you're quick enough. So anyway, let's carry on into the next corridor. Now, first, when you first start in Lumo, you can't jump or really do much. You're kind of stuck at a little walking speed. So when you reach this room here, you can push a box that says Rare Goods. Nice little nod to Rare there, I'm guessing.
Yeah, that's a bit more obvious.
Yeah. So we need to find a way to jump, basically. So if we head back this way and follow the arrow on the wall.
I was going to say, it's a good level design tip. If you want players to go right, put an arrow pointing left.
Exactly. I always do that. If a game scrolls to the right, I always go left. Just in case there's a secret there.
Everyone does.
And here's a book. A lovely little floating book. But I can't get it. I can't jump. So we're going to have to sort that out, Gareth. And if we carry on heading through here, through these little corridors. Now, graphics-wise, in this game, am I correct in saying that a lot of these graphics you got from Unity assets, or did you get artists?
No, there's a real mix. So the character art was done by a guy called Paul Large, who I used to work with, Ruffian. Stuff like the book and some of the textures and a lot of things like the walls and things I did. There is a lot of asset store stuff. I think I used two asset packs. There was a top-down dungeons, which provided a lot of the bottles and things like that. And there was another one I forget. Excuse me, I forget the name of now. But it is a real mix. I basically took every kind of shortcut I could to make the game. And there's some stuff I kind of bought off of Turbo Squid as well.
The majority of the programming was done by you solo.
Yeah. And most of the sound effects, the music track was done by a guy called Dope Demand. But towards the end of the game, I had learned enough kind of modelling, and I'd learned how to rig the characters, and I'd learned how to do the animation. So by the end of it, I'd hardly use any of the props and stuff. So you can kind of chart how I picked up the things I'd not done for a very long time as the game goes on.
Cool. Now, isometric games of old have always been a little bit tricky to control, but I really like the way that in this game you can actually choose your control. I don't know if I can do it until I get the book, but you can actually choose your control scheme in this using a little kind of Street Fighter 4 training room. I'll show that off in a bit. Right, so here we go. We've entered the room that gives you the ability to jump. Now, if you can see on top of that wall there, there is a glowing orb that looks very familiar to a glowing orb you might find in a game that Gareth has worked on before.
It is definitely not an agility orb, and it's definitely not the Ruffian Games logo with a really bad hat on.
Oh, it's not. Oh, okay. Fair enough then. That definitely didn't sound like collecting an agility orb sound either then.
No, it didn't. It is not the agility orb sound with me putting pitch bend on at all.
Okay. All right. I apologise for that terrible mistake. Congratulations to Gemspark, by the way. You got the first Steam code. Well done. Enjoy Lumo. So now the little guy even has the ability to jump. We're gonna check out a secret, because there are many, many secrets in this game. Not just Easter egg secrets, but
there's loads.
Collectibles
there's...
as well.
So the first one in here, the shelves in this zone, in the start section, are basically always a clue that you can jump out of the room. And most of the secrets in Lumo are about breaking the game in that way. If it looks like you can jump out of a room, you probably can. If it looks like you can break a game mechanic, you probably can. And they lead you to the cassettes.
So the cassettes, did you sample any particular game for that loading noise, or is it just a random loading noise?
So when you get stuck, when you get pulled into the game, it's the loading screen from RoboCop.
Amazing.
I forget which one that one is. I think it's either it's one of the Ultimate games. I was going to say Nightlore, but I'm not sure if it is. It's the header for it anyway, so you could probably use the sample on an emulator and find out which one it was.
Right.
But I had a bunch of them, and I literally was auditioning which one sounded better for about 2 days. So I've forgotten exactly which one that is, but the cassettes are a riff on the old Cascade compilation they did for charity games, Cascade Cassette 50.
I had Cassette 50. Was that the really terrible one?
The one with 50 of the worst games you've ever played. Yes, that's the one.
I've got that somewhere, I'm sure.
So that will give you a clue as to how many cassettes there are in the world.
50?
Yeah.
I'm showing off my brains today. Another collectible is these ducks, which they've been the cause of some of my biggest swears playing this game. Because you've got to jump as you collect them, so you don't fall through.
There's a trick to this. If you jump off high above them and then just press and hold the jump button again, it will automatically bounce. And it's the same for the bubbles as well.
What? You have to hold it.
Yeah, yeah. Oh. But you have to land. You have to land on his head.
Yeah.
Just literally aim for his head. So the one with the bridge, you can jump above, land straight on him and bounce straight off. And it's the same for the bubble mechanic in the game as well. It doesn't debounce the jump. So I'm not that evil. You don't literally have to time it perfect.
That's what I've been trying to do. That's probably why I've been cocking it up so much. If you see any graphical glitch, by the way, I noticed there was a little stutter in the graphics end. That's my capture card playing up, I think. It's definitely not the game.
So in the room with the box and the duck, if you jump onto the box and jump out to the right...
Oh my god, I just held down the jump button and it was so much easier getting the duck!
Yeah.
So there we go, I picked up the... I jumped out and found the secret hidden tape anyway.
Cool.
Amazing. I missed that one first time around, actually.
Yeah, there's the one people tend to miss on the start section is the one right by the spawning room, because there's another shelf up there in that room, and people tend to walk by that one and forget that one.
I don't think there's anything in this next room as far as I know.
Look for the shelves, they'll be the clue.
Yeah. Okay, right, I'm going to try this. Hold that. Oh no, I didn't jump right on his head that time. So there are 32 ducks in this game to collect, I think. Is there any significance to that number? Or is it just like it?
It's the programmer in me. It's like power of two.
I've got quite a fondness for the number 32 myself.
So I literally put the duck. I mean, I've played the start of this game, I don't know, hundreds of times, and this is really meant to just bed in the controls. So it's a lot of up, down, left, right. And I just wanted something that was a little bit more complicated for me, so I effectively have been speedrunning the game for about the last year.
Right.
So I put the ducks in purely just as a kind of little skill test for myself. And it's brilliant, because obviously the newer players, really start going after the ducks, so it actually treats a lot of the platforming stuff quite early, which has been good. And watching people like leave no duck behind, spending 15 minutes on a room has been brilliant. I've been in stitches at some of the streams the last couple of days.
What was the one that really got me? There was one that nearly made me cry. I think it was by some hanging chains.
Oh yeah, there's that one, and the one with the rotating metal pillar in the mines. That one's pretty evil as well.
Because if you pick it up, but then die, you lose it. You have to exit the room for it to get in. So some of them are, you have to collect them and then make it to the exit before it's saved.
We were doing the editorial press tour in the US, and in the end I was just like going, bank it, don't try it, bank it.
Phone a friend.
We were trying to get them to go through the game, and some people had spent literally the whole time they had with a preview stuck on like the first few rooms with the ducks, and we're like, oh god. Yeah.
Carry on.
No, I was going to say it was good, but I wanted them to see more of the game.
Fair enough. Well, I'm going to put a code warning. I'm going to put another PC code in the next 30 seconds, so keep an eye on the chat, people. I'm now also going to collect the book. So the book now allows me to press options, and I'll bring up the book. So is there any Easter eggs in relation to the book?
Yeah, so if you look at the border of the book, it will be very similar to the border of the box art from Nightlore. In the background on the pages, in the settings page, there is the circuit diagram for the Spectrum's OOLA, which was kind of like the chip that handled the output and stuff. And
whereabouts
also,
is that,
It's on the settings pages. If you write them. So yes. The one on the left is the Spectrum's OULA, and the one on the right is the Kempston joystick interface, which anyone who had a Spectrum or a CPC would kind of remember not working very well.
Definitely. I'll quickly show this because I did talk about the controls thing quickly. So there's three different ways you can control the game. Oh, I might not be able to test them now, actually. You might have to test them. Can you only test them at the start?
Oh, yeah, no, the dojo's just on the front.
Ah, the dojo's only at the start. Okay, fair enough. I go for the middle setting anyway. I find that one works best for me. So.
I go for the left because I can't do the diagonal jumps very well. So I do the room relative, but...
Cool. Right, let's continue onwards then. What's that little blue thing in the corner of the... by the door? There looks like
a little prop bob.
See, I'm thinking everything is an Easter egg now.
Yeah, I know, it's brilliant. It might be.
Right, so tape up here, I'm gonna guess. There we go. Look at this. Five tapes already.
Got the hang of this now.
Yeah. I missed most of these my first time.
Yeah, all of the secrets in the game follow a set of rules. The rules are introduced in the later sections. They're literally introduced once, but you have to be quite eagle-eyed to spot where I show you. But then they follow a pattern after that. So in this early zone, everywhere of a shelf, I think with one exception, has got a cassette in. And the later sections, they'll follow a similar pattern as well.
Cool. Well, we're in the room with a big Easter egg stroke tribute, I guess, to the game that... inspired the creation of Lumo.
John Ritten and Bernie Drummond.
Yeah, Bernie Drummond was the composer or the artist?
He was the artist, John Ritten was the programmer, and they worked together for a bunch of games. So, Match Day 2, Batman, Head Over Heels, Monster Max, maybe one more. But Head Over Heels was the one that got me started, that was the first one.
I read, you did an interview with Martin Robinson on Eurogamer a while back, and I'm pretty sure you said that it was a conversation with someone about Head Over Heels or something, about
Ice Ninja
Games that hadn't been made for ages, so it spurred you into making Lumo.
Yeah, that was Mr. Steve Pickford, who were part of the Pickford Brothers. Wow, like how many games have they made? They go back to right at the start of the Spectrum, but they're probably the kings of the isometric genre. They've made loads, like Mad Max and Amaru and Equinox. And he was talking on Twitter that he'd just seen a speed run for Equinox, which was their SNES 16-bit isometric game. And it was a beautiful game. I spent the summer trying to beat that game really hard as nails. And I was funny, literally had just seen a quicker speed run about a couple of weeks before, and I gave it to him. And I was just saying, I would love to have made one of these games back in the day. And he was just like, you should go for it. No one's done one in ages. And it's sort of been in my head that I needed to find something to do, you know, that I really believed in if I was going to, you know, work on my own. So I did a quick prototype. And I emailed it to him. It was like, this looks actually pretty cool. And that was it. That was Lumo, literally born in 2 days.
Amazing. I stood up for a second there while you were talking. I wasn't wandering off to be real. I was just picking up my copy of Head Over Heels.
Have you still got it?
Yeah, I got my Hit Squad tape. I got a little retro shelf next to my streaming setup. And as far as I know, it still works.
I've still got mine. I've still got my Multiphase 2. I've still got my CPC and Spectrum. So, I wouldn't part with those.
No, there's something. I just love having a shelf of little Spectrum games. There's something nice and tactile about being able to play with a cassette tape. Anyway, sorry. I was fell into a puddle of nostalgia there. The book on the floor, is that anything? Is that more set dressing?
No, that one's just set dressing. There's a couple of other things with the books later on. There was a guy called Zax who did some programming books for 6502 and the Z80, and his name's on the side of the leather Lumo book that you pick up, and his programming books are hidden in some of the rooms much, much further in the game. So there are a few nonsense books. Yeah. Anyone who started programming in the 80s probably had those books, so they recognised them from even a few pixels on the screen.
I'm doing terribly at getting this next duck. Come on. Well, I'll give it one more try and then I'll give up.
Yeah, so you're hitting the collision a little bit as you're jumping. So if you stay where you spawn and just go straight north, northwest, you'll land straight on it.
Okay. I'm falling too short. Right, I've given up on that. I've collected all these before.
You say that. Pictures or it didn't happen.
Oh no. Is this the right way to be going?
So if you go up northeast, there's the map. And
if
you go up northwest, it's back to the next fire cube.
Okay, so we'll pop this way because there's another little Easter egg here, which is actually, I noticed. Well, there's two Easter eggs here, I guess. This is a carpet from. Is that from the box of Nightlore? Is that?
No, Mayamere.
Mayamere.
Yeah, so it's the border from Mayamere.
So, and then we go in here, and this there used to actually be. This is an Easter egg of a broom cupboard, basically. That's a picture of a gopher up on the wall, but there used to actually be a picture of Gordon the gopher up there.
Yeah, so we put it to a vote on Twitter. It was either Ed the Duck or. Gordon the Gopher. Gordon the Gopher won.
Yeah.
So it was a proper photo of Gordon the Gopher, and then I got a little bit nervous because I'm actually going to sell some copies of this game. Maybe take that one out. So that's just a gopher now.
Fair play. But it's still a tiny little broom cupboard with
a
gopher.
It is a broom cupboard, yeah.
So harking back to the Phillips Schofield days. Keep an eye out on in the comments, peeps. I'm going to drop another PC code in there in the next minute or so. So that was a little nice little secret area. So we drop back down and head past this flaming obstacle.
Yeah, there's four zones in the game, so that one's just a little taster that you're going to go up and down. I always kind of imagine this as being like a real castle, and I think logically, bar one exception, you could probably make the entire game in Lego. The rooms do physically kind of fit together properly. I don't really bend space all that much, so.
So technically, yeah, if you could make it in Lego, technically we could recreate Lumo in Minecraft, maybe.
Yeah, it would be possible. It's even where the teleporters do link back to another zone. I did measure it so that it would work. And when I drew the map, I found one error basically, so it is possible.
Cool. Well, I've just reached a dead end. I need to double back on myself and find the map and all that stuff, I think. Oh, here we go. So I've reached the map room now. I'm going to use this special magic box to get to it. Now, the magic box disappears when you jump off it, and then when you jump again, it reappears. So you can use that to navigate some of the puzzles, and I've picked up now the map. Do we have any Easter eggs hidden on the map? It's the same.
Yes, we do. Will Overton in the chat can actually correct me if I'm wrong, but it's his map for Alien 8, I think, which appeared in Crash magazine. Can't quite see it at 1080, but when you see it at higher res, you can really clearly see that it's his old map from the magazine.
Hidden in the just really faintly in the background.
No, the actual thing in the world, the piece of paper that you pick up.
Oh, right,
So
cool.
As that spins around, it's got a compass overlaid on it, but
yes,
it's his original map.
Oh, God, I picked that up too quick to try and check it out now, but...
Yeah.
So we got the map now, so that's going to help us chart our way through. So we need to be going northeast.
Northwest. Go to the Chimera.
Cool. Boing. Now this game features pretty much. If you die, it's one hit kill, isn't it? On all the hazards.
Yeah.
Back in the Spectrum days, you'd get three lives, and then you'd have to start the whole game again. But the vanilla mode on this game is infinite lives, right? But you have included an old school mode.
Yeah, so the old school mode is it's a it's a pretty good challenge if you've not done adventure mode. If you've completed adventure mode, it should be a little bit easier. There are the map pieces in the world become lives, they become hats, so you can pick those up and get there's another 16 dotted around the world. But you have to kind of be careful. Like I've done old school mode with lives to spare, but I've not done old school mode and got all the ducks.
Right.
So,
okay. There's some proper challenge in there for people that really want it.
Yeah, because occasionally, you know, if you get a duck wrong, you might waste four or five lives. So
I know that feeling.
You need to be pretty perfect on that. But it's pretty easy to get to the end on old school. If you're just, you know, trying to get from A to B, it's not too bad. I'd be very interested when someone does that 100%, how long they spend on it.
Cool. Will Overton is in the YouTube chat right now at the moment. And he says, I didn't know that about the map.
I know, and I did ask his permission as well.
So obviously he did know, but he just forgot.
Well, I probably didn't tell him what I was going to put it on. Just
I see, fair enough. This room here, we've got a little Easter egg on the wall of another isometric game. That's the cover of Hydrofool, right?
No, Chimera.
Chimera?
Yeah, it's from Shahid Ahmed's isometric game. I think it came out on the C64 first.
Yeah.
And that's that should be the C64 cover. He gave me permission to do a kind of homage to it. So as you go up the lift, you're effectively entering one of the rooms from Chimera, and the little guy that walks around is a very poor rendition of the player character from Chimera, which I have to apologise for.
I'm just googling that now to have a look, because I thought it looked like the guy wearing a snorkel.
Yeah, it's pretty similar. If you look, Chimera is a guy in a spacesuit, but his spacesuit helmet's square. Literally just put two cubes together.
Oh, yes, I see it now. Crazy. When we enter this lift as well, we're going to hear a fantastic song by Whistling Rick Wilson. I nearly screwed it up then, and I'm only slightly drunk. Tell us about this song.
Yeah, Your Sinclair Represent. It was a cover mounted cassette. I think it was in October 86 or 88, I'm not sure. And one of the journos, for whatever reason, decided to put a Rick Astley pop song on the cover. And that was Hold My Hand Very Tightly. And I used to have this as my ringtone for ages, because it's one of those earworms that once it's in your head, you can transplant it to other people as well.
Yes.
And it goes around like a little virus. And I loved it. And it's just a total Your Sinclair in joke. But I managed to track him down on LinkedIn and was like, please let me use your song. And he was like, God, I hadn't even thought about it in 20 years. Sure, go for it.
I was doing some research on it, and it got played on Radio 1. Accidentally or something. I think they thought it was Rick Astley.
I think he was trying to take the mickey out of that, and it just obviously worked. But those Your Sinclair guys, it was such a little club back then. You kind of felt you were part of their little gang, and they just did really stupid things like Lawnmower Simulator. I was trying to get Lawnmower Simulator in for ages, and I couldn't think of anything that would just naturally fit, apart from like literally you push the lawnmower around.
I remember Lawnmower Simulator very well. So this is the Chimera room anyway, and the little robot going around, he's meant to be the guy from Chimera.
Yeah, he's the player character. I apologise so much. I really didn't spend enough time on that. Toasters kill you because toasters kill you back in the day.
Back in the 80s, anything could kill you in video games. Toilet lids.
Yeah, toilet lids.
Anything. Yeah. Right, back in the lift. Brilliant. Tuesday. There you go, I kind of know the lyrics.
It's my dream that one day they reform and I get to see that fun live.
That would be amazing. We need to start one of those online petitions.
Yeah. Sony Christmas party.
Yeah. You never know, it could happen. Right, so I've got a spanner now. The spanner is integral to moving forward in this game, so I'm heading off to use that spanner. past a bunch of pipes and into the room. A quick push on the spanner and that is going to start up a conveyor belt. And that's kicked up a load of boxes. Move down. A nice little cutscene showing now that a conveyor belt I went to earlier is now moving. I'm ready to jump on. When I played this game, actually, EGX, there was a cuddly toy that appeared on that conveyor belt, and I was like, oh, and a cuddly toy! But it's not there in this version.
No, it's random. It's random.
Oh, it's random.
It's not 100%, so I it took me ages to capture it for the green light video. I ended up putting the number up because I stood there waiting for it for ages. But yeah, it's just a completely random chance, basically.
Yeah.
If you do stand there for long enough in the room, you'll probably get one.
Cool. Nice little Easter egg, a Bruce Forsyth Easter egg.
Yeah.
Generation game.
Yeah.
Now this game, I'm streaming the game at the moment because of limitations and whatever. I'm streaming in 30 frames per second, but this game actually runs a nice smooth 60 frames per second. That's right.
Yeah. Definitely on PS4 and PC. If you've got like anything across like a 570, 580, it'll run 1080p.
Just left the room as the cuddly toy came out of the. You would have just got a little glimpse of the cuddly toy there.
It should have been cheap.
Yeah, you could have called it Anna Cuddly Toy.
Most of the achievements are really bad puns on the 80s anyways.
Are they? I haven't really looked, actually. I played, so this is my first time playing on the PS4. I played the Steam version, PC version 3. Which reminds me, I'm going to stick another Steam code in the next minute or so keep an eye out. If you guys and girls in the comments, actually, if you've got any questions for Gareth, if you want me to ask him any questions, do let us know in the comments, and I'll try my best to answer them.
Okay. The platinum achievement on PS4 is Ultimate Plate. I was quite proud of that.
That's a cool one. Right, this next bit is a true test of isometric platforming skills, and so we make it across moving platforms with insta-death balls of doom below. EGX, I fell off this so many times. Nearly fell off. I'm really taking my time now, but I did manage to race across it a few times.
It's set up so the minute you walk in the door, you can just run and go straight across.
I just fell off then, right at the end.
There's a bunch of the game that's set up for speedrunning, so this room's timed to speedrun. You literally enter and go straight across, and it's fine. And a lot of the other rooms are set up that way as well. But in general, Lumo isn't one of those games that actually rewards you for trying to be aggressive and run at it. It's actually a lot easier to play if take your time
from the start. Trying to take my time as much as I can with this one. Can't believe I fell off on the last.
I tend to find the D-pad's a bit easier for using the analog sticks.
Right, I'm using this stick. Could be my problem. There we go, right, we're through. Whew!
Yay.
Oh, my heart was in my mouth there. Question for Gareth, have you considered some kind of level editor add-on where people can create their own and share their own Lumo puzzles? That's from Olivia White, who, if I remember correctly, is the developer of a game called the Charnel House Trilogy.
Ah, yes. I did consider it, but it was kind of one of those things. Lumo grew out of a prototype, which was kind of very sort of quickly put together. And also, I didn't really know the Unity engine particularly well when I started, so I was kind of under a sort of cash time limit thing, and I was more focused on just trying to build the game for the first sort of 6 or 7 months, by which point it wasn't really built in any way that I could easily put the editor on, because in effect Unity is the editor for the game. There are a bunch of prefabs and bits and pieces that I can drop in, but nearly everything in the game is bespoke. Like, all of the rooms have their own logic, that's just scripted. Nearly all of the rooms have their own assets or their own kind of layout and stuff, so there wasn't enough sort of Lego bits and pieces to really make that possible. But I have been asked about it a lot, and if I ever, you know, go back to this genre, I probably will support that. I will do that.
If you ever go back, well, hopefully this will see a resurgence of isometric style games.
Yeah, I'm hoping it does, actually.
Anything that reminds me of my childhood is pretty cool by me.
I'd like Warner's to do an isometric Batman. We'd let Rocksteady go mental with it. That would be fantastic.
Yeah, that would be awesome. Now, this next little room that I'm in, this has got a couple of Easter eggs towards Rare, I think. This little box that's in love with me, it says Rare Goods on the side, and those googly eyes look very familiar to me. A little bit like some Banjo-Kazooie style eyes.
This, I have to give credit to Rob Fearon for this. There was the Twitter googly eye challenge that was happening about 2 years ago. And I can't remember who started it or how it led to this, but googly eyes started getting applied to things. And I had this box walking around, so I was like, right, I'm winning this. So I put the googly eyes on the box. And then slowly over time, he became the love box. So, yeah. If he can't see you, he gets a little bit confused, goes cross-eyed and just wanders off. And then if he does see you, he'll emit the hearts and
follow
you around. And then obviously the Rare Goods is a very overt reference to Rare. So, yeah, full credit to Rob for that. That was his challenge.
There we go. It looks like Olivia knows Rob Fearon because she's just typed Rob Fearon in capital letters.
Sir Rob.
That's a good question. Stroyer says, what is in the box?
I haven't looked.
Yeah, he's not looked.
I got, yes, you know, same thing. What sex is the player character? I don't know.
Yeah. It's open to interpretation. Right?
There's definitely feet in the box because you can hear them. So.
Right. So there's something alive in there, but we've we'll never find out. Maybe if there's a sequel to Lumo, we'll find out.
Well, that would be the DLC, wouldn't it? Players in the box.
Now, that's what I call a weighted companion cube, says John D. Right. So, we are moving onwards. Viewers, by the way, the Steam codes are now all gone. In the next minute or so, I'm going to drop the first PS4 code into the chat. Now, the PS4 codes are EU only, so European PS4 codes only. If you live in America, I'm afraid you won't be able to claim the code. So, open to EU people only, but there are five copies of Lumo to give away on the PlayStation 4. Right, we got another map anyway. Another map thing spinning around. Seeing if we can. That's too far away for me to be able to see, but maybe.
Do you recognise it, Will? Will Shutterhand.
Will, can you recognise that?
In between those pixels.
So, did Will, this map. It was in your Sinclair, did you say?
No, I think it was in Crash.
In Crash?
It was, you know, you had to do the hand drawn maps of the old isometric games.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there was no other map, and they used to print them in the magazines, and that was Will's submission.
Was that when... Was Will... Because Will is a professional artist. He's done a lot of stuff for video games, video game magazines, manga magazines. Was this before Will was a professional? Is this like some... Because I once sent in a solution for Dizzy to a Spectrum magazine.
I had a letter printed in Amstrad Action. I'm guessing so. Will did the covers for Superplay magazine. And he did the key art for Lumo, so the cartoon wizards and stuff you see in all the promotional material, that's Will as well.
In the thumbnail for this video, I've used that artwork.
It's gorgeous. And there's so much detail in it. You keep looking at it and you're like, I didn't even see that.
No, it's awesome, especially once you've played through the game and then you look at it and you're like, oh, I know that. I know where that's from.
Brilliant.
So this puzzle had me stuck a little bit. All right, PS4 code anyway. I'm going to crack that in now. Am I? No? There we go.
The thing with these is this is 8-bit physics. It's not real world physics. We've gone back in time, so
yeah.
That's why you can only push things in certain directions.
Yeah. So you need to push this one out slightly from the back, and then you have to lead him round. Ah, oh, he's cute. And drop him there, and then jump up. And so what am I about to collect on here? What is this?
So this is the first of the kind of machine parts. We're going to, we're basically building a machine to get home. And this is the SD card, which is holding the OS. And a couple of references. Obviously, I'm using my name for the brand. There's Hollyhop, which is Red Dwarf.
Yeah. Prodigy there, Take Your Brain.
Yeah. Take Your Brain to Another Dimension. Big Prodigy fan. I listened to quite a lot of old school when I was developing Lumo. So it's creeped into the game in a few ways. This is the first.
Yeah, Hollyhop is Red Dwarf. And GN Tech, Gareth Noyce Tech.
Yeah.
There's a lovely Gareth Easter egg. Yeah, I won't spoil it. But there's one at the end of the game that made me chuckle. Oh,
I can't say what that was.
No. Right. So this one, you got to be nice and quick doing these floor buttons. Bing. Ah, it wasn't quick enough.
That was the second room that I actually built. The first one was the sporting room.
Yes.
This musical floor. Billie Jean tiles, I think.
Billie Jean tiles. Ding, ding, ding. There we go. I did it that time. Shall I risk trying to get the duck? I think the door's open.
Leave no duck behind.
I've already left one duck behind. I'll try and take this duck with me. Come on, duck. Hup! Yeah! There we go. Oh my god, it's so much easier if you hold down the button. Is this duck going to take me outside as well? No. Bloody handprint on the wall there. Is that an Easter egg to anything?
Cadaver, Bitmap Brothers.
Right. I'm not familiar with that one.
It's the Amiga Atari ST isometric game that they made just before Speedball, I think, maybe after Gods, I forget which order. So obviously their logo was the black hand with the lines through, and it's a really, I apologise, it's a very bad interpretation of the first room from Cadaver, but you'd be like a little dwarf in your armour and there was a little boat that had pulled up to the kind of castle you were exploring. So
so it's not even just the hand, it's the whole layout of the level.
No, it's a very bad interpretation of Cadaver. I still wasn't modelling them.
Yeah. So I saw also on Twitter that you're doing a director's commentary.
Yeah, I am. I've just put the first part up on my YouTube channel last week. The second part will go up on Friday, and I'm just going to go through week by week. So it'll be a lot of the stuff that we're discussing today, but then obviously I'm going to go all the way through the game. So at the minute I can't decide if I'm going to show all of the secrets or if I'll kind of like just say there's a secret in here. So I'm going to put that to a Twitter vote next week, because I'm at the point now where I've given away quite a lot.
Yeah, I saw you give away something about the ice stairs.
Yeah, a lot of reviewers got stuck on that. I won't name names, but a lot of reviewers got stuck on that. To the point where I think if I'd have taken that room out, it might have actually positively affected my reviews.
Oh my god.
So, I'd had a couple of glasses of wine last night, so I thought, you know what, this is the solution for this one. Because it is quite a tricky room, and there's red in it as well, so...
Yeah. It is very tricky, but I did it without any help, so I'm proud of that.
Yeah, Eurogamer. Yeah. No help.
No help, Eurogamer, indeed. Oh god, I need some help doing this jump. I don't want to leave the duck behind, but at the same time... Oh no, I fluffed it. Screw it. I'm going to leave him behind. I'll come back for you, ducky friend.
I know,
I feel bad now. keep an eye out on the comments, peeps. I'm going to stick another PS4 code in a minute. Let's quickly head down here. I think there's an impassable room here. Oh no. I think we have a different place.
Ollie Space just asked, are there any Paradroid Easter eggs? No, I didn't put any Paradroid stuff in. I was leaning a little bit more towards Jeff Minton and Andrew Braybrook. This one. There's a couple of Jeff Midnight Easter eggs.
Fair play. Is there anything? Right, it's this next room, isn't it? The donuts or whatever these are. What is that?
I've got the leg. It was the long corridor with the boxes in. There was a door going northwest, and then you go through the table chairs.
Cool. Now I'm in the donut room now.
Yeah.
What's the donuts reference?
This was someone asked me on the retro game forum when I was advertising the green light. I mean, you're going to put some donuts in the game. And in Head Over Heels, the ammo that Head had for his gun was 6 donuts.
Right.
And so I was like, yeah, I'll put donuts in. So I put in a whole room of donuts. And unfortunately, it's confused all of my American friends because they think they're bagels. So I should have
I can see how a little bit more donut-y.
Maybe put some pink icing on them.
Yeah, some little sprinkles or something,
yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah. I didn't think of that when I did it. But yeah, big Head Over Heels salute there.
Cool. And how about this table? Is this table anything or...?
No,
I guess it's just props. See, I'm trying to find Easter eggs in everything now. What could that knocked over chair mean?
The table was made by my boss at the university where I teach, so I have to give props to the table. No secrets on that one, unless he's hidden something in the normal map.
Fair enough. Oh, Iarenas chooses to believe they're bagels. Fair enough.
Yeah,
Sam was 1, 2, 3 thought they were Sonic rings. that's a stretch. I mean, oh god, here we go, hit the lasers.
The coins were nearly Sonic rings, but I thought that was kind of going a bit too far.
Right. Come on, don't die. Oh, I fell off. Oh god. It's pressure having to play games live and think about talking. The pressure is just immense. Oh, god damn it! It's all about the timing. That one goes. I can't jump it. No!
Yeah.
I was too soon. Right, and go.
So when the middle one goes, just kind of wait half of its time.
Yeah, there we go. We're through. Left another duck behind, but we'll gloss over that.
I'm going to pretend the ducks aren't in there now.
Going to leave now, says Will Overton. Suffice to say, the game is fantastic and everyone needs to go play it.
Well,
thank see you later, Will Overton. Thanks for coming along to the stream, sir.
Yep. Thanks for your fantastic art as well, Will.
Okay. And now a room full of lasers and fans. What could possibly go wrong?
This room is so much softer than it used to be. I watched thousands of deaths in this room.
Yeah.
It was fantastic. Way, way too difficult. It took me ages to kind of find the balance for the game because where I end up playing a lot of the stuff, and I was originally I was making stuff mainly for green light video, which is this room, those rooms. So there was no real conception of where it should actually go in the game, and they were kind of built as sort of individual rooms originally. But I had linked them all up, so you could kind of run through everything that I'd built and sort of play it. And I took it to Assembly, which is like a demo party in Helsinki in the summer. And I go to a bunch of friends and it was hilarious because there was 3 of these laser pillars and the timing was really syncopated between the lasers and, oh wow, like 30 minutes and they couldn't get through it. And I was just like, right, okay, I should probably leave.
Yeah, maybe tone it down for the earlier levels.
Yeah, there was a bunch of stuff that I had to actually take out and remodel in the later zones because they're just, you know, you couldn't put them in the first hour of the game.
Yeah.
So there was a bunch of stuff like that.
I mean, at the moment, the platforming is pretty simple, but it does get brutal in places later on, for definite. Code, PS4 code is coming into the chat, into the comments in the next 30 seconds to a minute. Right, we can't get past that room anyway. That had "clean me" written on the wall, but there's no way past that room, so I need to head over this way and try and find a way to clean the water, I presume. These little backwards little rolling balls you have to run on that will they kind of reverse your controls a bit. I tried to get the dive and I cocked out.
Game design, this is the first thing you're told never to do. Don't reverse the player's controls. And I was kind of like, I'm blatantly reversing the player's controls.
Well, to be fair, there was a lot of games that reversed controls back in the ZX Spectrum days.
The reason I really did it is because the kind of sort of Spin Dizzy Marble Madness sort of minigame, and you really need some training for that, because you can't just go in it and then have done. So this was always kind of done with an eye of how to make that actually quite playable. And the balls in this section of the game are much slower and much heavier than the one in the actual mini game. So you kind of train, you know, much easier, really.
Yeah.
When you get to the mini game, it's much looser and much faster. But hopefully you've kind of got your head around it by then.
Yeah. Well, I managed it all right, and I got the duck from that one, so... good. An isometric style game that I really liked back in the day, a Rare game as well, was Snake Rattle and Roll.
Yeah.
And that had a power up, or some, a pick up that reversed your controls.
Yeah, I remember that.
That was the cause of many deaths.
Right. Honestly, I know a few people swear at me the minute they see that, because it's like, don't do that.
I got back into Snake Rattle and Roll when it was released on Rare Replay recently, but I just couldn't do the boss. It just kicked my ass.
You can go a little bit further out on that shelf. You can imagine the player's like a big sort of tic-tac.
Yeah.
So you can actually... It's not quite the same as the really pixel-perfect things on the 8-bit games.
Yeah.
But this is the first kind of max... jump in the game, and I use it a couple of times later on as well, so this is just to get you
I definitely need to be
and go straight as well, you don't want to go back.
Oh no, then I just jumped into the wall. God, it's a good job I'm not streaming the later levels, you'd hear some swears.
Yeah, that's much better towards the end.
Okay, here we go. Oh, what? I just didn't even press jump. Bottled it. So now I've got to head out and reset the room. This time, I'll do it this time. Okay. I've just whacked that code in anyway.
Hang his feet right over the edge.
Yeah. Bop, 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 bop. Right on the edge. A little bit of a run up and jump. Yes, I did it.
So I think there's three locations in the game that are like a maximum jump. Jump, and that was the first one.
Oops. Fell right off. Can I go under that little fan? Looks like I can.
Yeah, red lettering.
And ignore the duck. Sorry, duck. I know, but like I said, I did get all the ducks first place, so it kind of redeems me a little bit, surely.
I think you're going to have to tweet the achievement icon for that with your name.
So I'm now standing on a little, I'm just standing on a little roller and drop some soap into the water, which has now cleaned the water and meant some bubbles have appeared. The bubbles took me a little while to get used to jumping on as well.
Yeah, they're the same trick. You can literally just hold the jump button and it'll bounce. It's way too hard to time the jump otherwise, so it's not fun, do you know what I mean? So I do help you with that.
Is the soap you bought a reference to anything?
No, soap on a rope, don't drop soap. It's just a really bad joke that I need to stop laughing. I apologise to everyone in advance. The bubbles, though, they're more because of bubble is the theme that kind of runs throughout the game. A, because it's amazing. And B, because I was going to sort of set up a room to look like a bubble level.
Yeah.
I did Donkey Kong instead. And the bubbles had collision on, they were kind of evil. But then when I jumped on them, I was like, oh, this is even better. I've got bubble. So I was like, I have to use the bubbles in a few places now just because.
Yeah.
And they were another thing, but really super early, like first sort of 2 or 3 months, I sort of stumbled on those. But bubble with the letters and the mini games and stuff is a kind of theme, because I use the extend stuff for bubble.
I managed to get two letters of the extend when I played.
Yeah, they're not designed to get first time. I have to be honest, I purposefully did them to be quite difficult.
Some of the time limits are pretty brutal.
Yeah, it is. There's an exploit, though, because the game doesn't actually save when you're in the minigame. So if you want to be cheeky, you could quit out of the game and have another go.
Wow. If only I'd known that first time around.
Yeah, awesome. I left it in on purpose, basically. There is a little exploit. And there's another exploit with the wand lamp as well. If you do run out, you can just reload the game and it will charge back up again. I like those sort of cheats because they are cheating, but
they're also, you could also say they're a little bit reminiscent of the way we had to cheat retro games at times, I guess.
Yeah, it is totally. There's a couple of things that are typing on the keyboard in the right place and you'll unlock stuff, and then those kind of exploits, it's like they did come up in QA and it's like no, I want them there on purpose, really. And it just thinks, word of mouth, you would uncover when you share with the school and stuff, so I kind of like that.
Yeah, back in the days before the internet.
Yeah, right. Your Sinclair Tip Shop.
Yeah. Back in the day. There was an Easter egg later on. I'm pretty sure was it the letters page guy from Your Sinclair or something?
The train spotter.
Yes, that's it.
Yeah, that so there's train spotter and Rockford.
Yeah.
So they're the two gravestones in the church. Mm. And the train spotter was kind of used in the letters page and then on like competitions and stuff. It used to pop up quite regularly in the magazine. And Rockford was he used to be in like the page borders on Crash or Zap, I forget which one, Zap probably.
Okay.
So I kind of like that because they were in the graveyard because they're dead.
Yeah.
So that was always quite funny. I quite like that.
Yeah. even Easter eggs to the old school magazines of the day.
Yeah, well, they were kind of important. It was, I mean, you have the same sense of community now with Eurogamer and stuff. It's a much bigger community, obviously, but things like the live stream and YouTubes and stuff. Is just a larger version of kind of what we had, I guess. But where the magazines, I think, developed slightly differently to the websites was the voice that they would have. And it would tend to go across the entire magazine, and the in-jokes and stuff would build up year over year over year. Until you get stupid things like hold my hand very tightly. So, growing up in that was just a small kind of bubble of what we now on a big scale now. It's... I'm pretty sure you'll look back in 10 or 15 years and you'll have the same sort of memes coming out of what we're doing now with the live streams and stuff. You'll look back on it just as fondly. It's just a slightly different way of doing the same thing.
I've got some issues of Your Sinclair knocking around as well.
I've kept all of mine, actually.
Because Your Sinclair was like almost like the spiritual daddy of Amiga Power, which was one of my favourite ever magazines.
Yeah, it was Your Sinclair Game Zone, PC Zone, were all basically the same crowd, but Amiga Power was definitely the same ilk, I think. And it was that kind of irreverent, let's not take games too seriously, which, it's computer games, let's not take it that seriously.
Exactly.
I kind of grew up a bit that way. And loved all of those magazines, to be fair, but it's... I just wanted to celebrate it. We kind of forget our history when we're making. We don't really look back unless we're doing like a remake or something, and Lumo was a good opportunity to be like, well, hang on now, there's loads of people I really admire that did this stuff before me, and I just want to give a nod and a salute, and it's almost like a thank you, because that stuff was cool to me and that's what inspired me to work in the games industry. So
I mean, it's a very, this game is inspired so much by the gaming scene of the UK. Are you worried at all that some of it might go over the head of international audiences?
Yeah, but that's fine. I wanted to make a British game. Mm-hmm. It's all of the AAA games I worked on, I think, pretty much, except Fable, were completely directed at a US or wider audience. And that's fine, but when you're a team of Brits, you know, I really wanted the cars in Crackdown 2 to drive on the other side of the road. But it's like you can't do it because the mobile players, you know, don't know how to drive on that side of the road. So I don't have to pander to that now. It might be a mistake. It might affect how people understand it. But, you know, I want to make a game that's a bit more invested in my personality, really. So that's why Lumo's got so many bad jokes, because like, I'm very funny.
Oh, no, I love the fact that there's like a game out there that's kind of catered to the, you know, the old school bedroom developer specky years. It was made for people of, you know, my age to enjoy.
It is to a degree, because, you know, I'm, you know, probably similar age, not that much different, and it would be great if we could see more of it. Yeah, 21. 21 again this year.
And, exactly.
Looking fantastic for it, not grey hair on my head. That's a big shame about losing Lionhead. You know, they made some very British games, so I hope, you know, what comes out of that, you know, carries on that tradition. We've, you know, Hello Games, that I'm pretty sure there'll be a lot of that kind of cultural personality in No Man's Sky, so I'm really looking forward to that as well.
I can't wait for that game. Not long now until No Man's Sky's out.
I'm definitely on the hype train.
Yeah, me too. I'm really looking forward to it. Comments. Stand by for another PS4 code for Lumo. If you have managed to get a code, by the way, do pop over to Gareth's Twitter. I'm going to put his Twitter handle in the chat now. If I spell it right, with a K, right? Corruptor with a K.
Yeah, K.
If you've got Twitter and you want a copy of the game, do pop over and say thanks to Gareth on his Twitter. Right, time to ride the bubbles up. This is a bit... whether or not it was based on it or not, this is a bit bubble dizzy.
This was literally as close as I got to that bubble mechanic of riding the bubble to the top of the level. I did try and set up a whole room to look like a level, but it just didn't work in isometric, so this was as close as I got.
This room was made me weep. It was oh damn it. I think it was because there's no door. Is there a door on the other end? There isn't, is there? So you have to go across, get the duck, and then get back to be able to
So the way I do it is go onto the box, jump on the bubble right until the top, which is four jumps I think, and then bounce the shelf off the shelf to get the cassette, then come back in, go from the shelf to the duck to the map. And then if you get it perfectly with the D-pad, you can go diagonally from the far right stone, and you don't have to get the bubbles back. If you're not feeling brave with your diagonals, then you have to kind of get the bubble to get back, which is difficult.
Pop the balloon. Pop the bubble.
Yeah.
Come on. Right. Maybe I will...
Yeah, it's brutal. It's
I was trying to go for the tape, but I think I might just not. Oh, Jesus.
This isn't one of the ones that really you're meant to rinse right at the start. This is one of those ones that, for the achievement in plain sight, to be difficult.
Oh my God, I am dying so much. I'm jumping too early now. Right, I'm gonna get the map this time, I promise. 2, 3. Okay, I'm onto... Oh wait, can I get across to the bricks that way? No! Alright, this time. Okay. 1, 2, 3. Boink! Okay, map is mine.
Right, so you can just die and get back out, really.
Okay, yeah, I could do. I've just jumped and got the duck. I'm going to try and get the duck.
Oh, wow.
Oh, no. Lost the duck. Screw it. See you later, my little ducky friend. Did I put that code? Right, that code. I need to put that code in, don't I? There we go. Boop. Yeah, you get a bit of a perverse, some perverse pleasure watching people raging at the game?
Yeah, I've got to be honest, I really do. not in like an evil way, but like someone got stuck on one of the rooms, took a screenshot of it, tweeted me a whole load of obscenities, and I had to walk away because I was cracking up. Because it's like, I know you can do it, and it literally, he put the game down, and he came back the next day and did it like a second or third time. But if like someone's genuinely confused, or you know, they really don't get what I'm doing, then that's not funny. Yeah. But if someone's just like, they get that rage and they just start throwing themselves at a jump or duck, and I'm just cracking up because it's perfect. That's exactly what I was sort of trying to do with some of those.
Most of the puzzles in here, some of them are quite obscure, but when you do kind of get them, you're like, oh, it's so easy in hindsight.
It's the same. Yeah, I think that's the same with all the puzzles. I took out loads of them because I didn't want you to be stuck because of a brain fart. I thought it was, you know, far more acceptable to like have kind of a skill shortage and then be like, okay, so I can put it down, I'll come back and I'll practice a bit and then I'll get it. And that for me seems a little bit fair. But what the puzzles that are in there, I thought were really, really simple. They were much easier than the ones I took out. And wow, like people get stuck on the SD card. I saw it on the press tour. Someone was there for about 10 minutes and I had to say, no, you do this and you do that. And then, like my friends, one of my friends' kids, you know, they couldn't work out the jump box. They just sent me two screenshots. And like, what do I do? Okay. So, you know, it's difficult to know where to go with these things. I do want this to be a game for kids to play a lot, but I'm not expecting kids to do all the skill challenges or pick everything up. But I would expect them to get, you know, pretty much to the end.
Yeah.
And the rest of the stuff I see as like layers. So, you know. You'll just pick certain bits to do and then you'll skip other things.
Fair enough. This teleporter here, is this a head over heels teleporter?
Yeah.
I wasn't 100% sure.
I did actually ask John Ritman, it's like, can I please use your teleporters? And I sent him a screenshot of them. And that's the 8-bit teleporter poster at the front end. He said, yeah, you can use the original graphics for it as well.
Awesome.
That was really cool. I was trying not to be a fanboy because I kind of found him on Facebook and I was like, please, Mr. Ritman, can I, like...
please be my friend.
Please, can I use...
8-bit friends.
And then he got the message back and I was like, John Ritman, message me!
Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God!
Literally one word, yes.
Yeah. Incredible.
So I've got a screenshot of it. So.
You said it. Favorite, best screenshot ever. So one thing I was wondering, like, because moving around in isometric viewpoint is kind of challenging, especially if you've never played one of these before. But you've spent over a year developing this game now. Are you just a master at isometric movement, or do you still? Are there still times when you misjudge your jumps?
To be fair, I've spent longer than that because I must have head over heels was the only game for like an entire summer. And then you think how many games came out in that style. So you had like Great Escape and the Earth Stood Still or something, the black and white. There was just loads of them. I used to pick them all up. I was a complete sucker for it. The only thing I noticed that was different, I used to play with the orientation the other way around on the spectrum than I did with Lumo. Okay. For some reason, I don't know why, it just felt wrong. And when I go head over heels, I play it the other way. That's the only real difference. So I never really had a problem with it at all. When I built the rooms, well, obviously I've got the advantage because I know where everything is.
Yeah.
But I'm not, I wasn't getting that blinded by the isometric. And it's the reason why I used a perspective camera rather than the, you know, axonometric orthographic camera. Is you have some depth, so it gives you a little bit clearer understanding of the room. And with all the lights...
Oh, sorry, Karen.
I was going to say, with all the lights and the shadows, I'm just trying to add more cues all the time. But
yeah, I mean, some of the rooms, can I do it on this one? Yeah, some of the rooms you can slightly change the perspective, which helps you judge the jumps a little bit better. I always found it looking where my shadow was helped helped me out.
Yeah, I was dead against that for a long time, but I was finally convinced. Originally, you never had the drop shadow because I didn't like it. I don't think it looks good, but I do. Yeah, I did eventually come around to the fact it's essential. So the camera tilt you can do on any room where the camera's static, but where the camera scrolls, you don't need it, so you can't do it.
Because there are different levels in this that aren't just this isometric viewpoint. There are other levels that are kind of little plays on other classic games. There's a little manic miner one.
The entrance to the mine's got manic miner reference. Everyone thinks I've nicked the minecart out of Donkey Kong, but I'd actually watched Indiana Jones and I nicked it out of that.
Oh, right. Okay.
And in the mini games, there's kind of Zaxxon-ish, or you know, the old isometric shoot 'em ups. There was another one on Neo Geo, I forgot the name of. There's a sort of spin on that. There's a one that I thought I invented, but was actually Devil Dice on PlayStation 1. But I genuinely had never heard of the game before until someone said, "That's Devil Dice," and I was like, "Oh." And then there's Nebulous, because, like, oh my god, I really want to make a Nebulous. If I get some time, I really want to make a Nebulous.
Nebulous was great. I didn't get to play the Nebulous, the Lumo version of Nebulous. So how do I get out of this room?
Right, so go back the way you came.
Oh, I remember now. It's under the... Sorry, I was trying to jump back up.
Yeah.
Sorry, that's my...
You need to go to the point gun.
Yeah, I'm on the right track now. Sorry, didn't mean to butt him. Nebulous anyway.
Nebulous, and then I took the bubbles to the logical extreme and sort of did a bounder type thing. Although that has to be the most brutal minigame out of all of them. Even I can't do that all the time. And then the last one is kind of like a spin dizzy Marble Madness thing. So it was really, initially it was like I really wanted to try and get as many of the isometric game mechanics in as possible. So not all of them are going to fit into a room. So the ones that didn't is like, okay, I'll do the mini game thing. And the mini games are really there because to break up the flow, and because the whole premise is you've been sucked into a game. So where you fall out of the world, and where the warp zone is like hidden, you're breaking the game, and all of a sudden it's that kind of Tron thing. It's like, oh look, there's other games in this universe. It's like I've been sucked into, you know, it's the Tron,
the video game world, rather than just one game. I see. Right, I'm just firing balls at the target now. Maybe there we go. My aim was on point.
If you get that bang in the middle, there's a little picture of Jeff Minter will pop up.
Oh, really? That's
super. Yeah, because he likes his bullseyes.
Oh, I've already hit it, and no,
yeah. So the balls are obviously the Amiga Boing balls. Anyone who's a big Amiga fan.
Oh, the screensavery Boing balls. Is that what they're from?
Do you remember? You remember the Amiga demo where there was the red and white checkered ball bouncing around?
I do. Can't remember where I saw it.
Yeah, it was the first demo they did for the Amiga A1000, I think, back in 85. And it was called the Boing Balls. It was kind of like the Amiga mask.
The Boing Balls.
Yeah, so those are the Boing Balls. In fact, when you bring up on the PC version, the mouse pointer is actually the Amiga mouse pointer.
awesome.
I'm a massive Amiga fanboy.
Oh, incredible. I need to put another code in because we're running out of time. We've only got 12 minutes left on the stream. I've still got two PS4 codes left, so watch the comments, because in the next 30 seconds to a minute I'll be putting a code in. I keep dropping off these ledges. So are you pretty happy with the response you've been getting to Luma at the moment? It's been reviewing really well, I've noticed, and I guess you're having lots of retro fans contacting you and
I'm so nervous, you wouldn't believe it. Like the last sort of 6-8 weeks waiting for it to come out. Horrible. So yeah, it was fantastic. I think the Eurogamer review was the first one I heard about, and it was like, oh
yeah,
that was so much better than I could have, you know, hoped for.
Awesome.
And over Twitter, the reaction has been great, because it's been a real mix. There's a lot of people who never played the original games and just really like the kind of character and the setting.
Yeah.
And, you know, most of the Easter eggs are pretty hidden. They're not, apart from the mini games, you know, most of them are just, you know, little subtle textural things or stuff like that. So they just like the game, and that's great. And then the rest of my Twitter feed is people taking screenshots of things going, I know what that is. So yeah, that's been really lovely. Really good. I've not really read all of the reviews. I'm trying to like avoid it because I don't want to be like flattened and I don't want to be upset. So I'm trying to sort of
fair enough.
I'm trying to stay neutral, and the more important thing to me is kind of like the reaction of players. And that's been super positive. Some people just love it, and that's just made me so happy because they've just kind of got what I was getting for the sort of tone and playability.
Yeah, that's that's my favourite thing about the game is the Easter eggs and the tone and just the throwback to this. Just my childhood gaming memories. I really appreciate all that.
That's
kind of
really
stuff.
What I was trying to go for. I mean, it's. I imagined it really like the kid in the game is me. It's me as 11 years old. And I was trying to really capture that feeling of like. You look at it now and head over heels looks rubbish, but at the time it was amazing.
Oh, yeah.
Like, oh my God, there's this entire world. And I was absorbed by it completely. You know, just like, this is unbelievable.
I remember the first time I found out that there was like a extra world you could go to.
Yeah.
And I was like, what? Oh my God.
I tell you what, I swear, for the first month I was playing it, I didn't know there was a bag and I didn't know you could pick things up. So
it's the days before the internet. You have to work
when
these things
out. When I read the playthrough and saw the map, me and my friend used to play it, and we'd take turns. So one of us would be on the map, and the other person would be playing. And we'd go, right, no, left here, right, up, down, you know, get this, do this. Oh, man. So, yeah, Lumo's, for me at least, is a reflection of that. It's like, you know, I'm now in a position where I can actually make my own version of that thing. I just wanted to give it like as much respect as I could. You know, I've purposefully stayed true to the template of the original because I wanted to make one of those original games. Like, there's loads of ways I could have changed it, but it would have become Zelda. It would have become, you know, something else. So.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's awesome that you've been able to do this kind of passion project. I'm guessing because it's an indie kind of game, you haven't had any like pressure to. Change too much?
No, I mean, we played it safe. There was really cheeky references in there. There's a few things that I was quite sad to see go, but we couldn't get clearance for. But on the flip side of that, everyone we tracked down and everyone that we asked has said yes, and they've like been really super positive and really helpful, and that side of it has been fantastic. And you know, massive shout out to Gary Penn, because like he got in touch with Oliver Frey and a bunch of old developers and really helped the process along. And then once that had kind of kick-started, everyone was like, yeah, sure, you know. A lot of people just really wanted, you know, to see their stuff back in the game again.
They're
really happy.
That's cool.
You know, the Brits are, you know, friendly bunch, particularly the original old-school guys.
Definitely. What's next for AAA production then? What have you got anything planned, or are you taking a bit of a break now that Lumo's out? You're having a bit of a breather?
I hate to say it, but a lot of it really depends on Lumo. Like everything I had went in the funding of Lumo. So I've got a little bit of cash kind of from the advance from the publishing deal, but the rest is like, you know, let's see how the sales do. I really have a good, strong idea for what I want to do next, but Lumo, I really didn't have enough cash to do it at the start. And I don't quite want to push myself, you know, that close to the edge. But it looks good, you know, reaction's been great. You know, the next couple of weeks I'm supporting Lumo, and I'll have a couple of weeks off in July for holiday, and then I'm going to be straight back on something. And
well, there you go, viewers. If you like the look of Lumo and you want more of the same, buy it. help fund the next whatever.
Help fund the starving game developer.
Exactly. Yeah. I can't believe I managed to do that room where you balance the ball across.
I know.
That thing so quickly. I was stuck on that for about 10 minutes when I first played.
It's because the ball doesn't go with a platform, isn't it? It's really confusing.
Yeah, and that would be all right if your controls weren't also.
If I wasn't
reversed.
Completely evil.
Hey, there's no secret up this bit. your T's.
Yep.
So I'm touching that way, no.
If it looks like you can get out of a room, you probably can. Well, no, it is. The door's in the middle. The door's always in the middle of the wall. So the boxes are a little bit of a red herring.
Ah, right, okay.
So if you jump a little bit to the left and go across, you'll be...
Oh, there we go. Oh, look at that. I thought you were being cruel.
I'm sort of teaching you that the invisible doors act like the real doors, because it's right. Not very often that I put the real doors to the sides. So.
I see. Viewers, one more code to give away. It's going to go in the chat in the next 30 seconds to a minute. So, what's going on here? Random as I thought someone wanted to ask a question in the comments, but it just looks like someone's shouting. never mind, right. So we've got about 5 minutes left, Gareth. Is there anything else you want to talk about?
We talked about director's commentary and stuff. That'll be the place where I talk about everything that we've missed today.
Sorry, hold on. I posted the wrong code. That's what people were saying. So carry on.
All I would say about the section that we've played right now is this is kind of like the sort of tutorial stuff. There's a few tests for your agility. But the game towards the later stages does open up a lot more. It's linear right at the start, and it'll slowly kind of progress into this kind of hub world where the final four zones and stuff are. So the game does change and evolve quite a lot, and you have different sets of mechanics in every single zone. So we keep showing the start of the game quite a lot, because that's what was shown in the videos for the press tour and stuff as well. But the second half of the game does actually feel quite a lot different, and you play with more sort of toys.
There's definite differences in the scenery as well. You've got the slippy, slidey ice world, and swimming levels and levels with horrible spidery things.
There's a bit of Hydra Fall in there. There's some cauldrons from Night Lore, lots of different types of flip floors and deadly traps, and the secrets get a lot more convoluted. There's loads of hidden passageways, and the wand kind of illuminates little pathways to get to different areas of the game. The pickups change as well, because you need to get the coins to spend on the arcade doors to get to the mini games. Yeah. So there's a big bunch of stuff that we haven't really, you know, looked at today, but it unlocks really the further you go. So it's a bit old school as well in that sense, which I quite like.
What would you say is your favourite Easter egg that you included?
I really like the cassettes, because it's such a bad joke. And you have to be such a certain age to get it. I've seen so many people go, why are there cassettes? I quite like that one. My favourite thing out of everything, though, is probably the Nebulous. Because it doesn't make any sense in the game. It's the second E, I think.
The second E. Okay, cool. I'm going to have to try my best to find that one.
The best thing that I got permission for was the Zap64 logo. I can't, you know, Ollie and Roger King, you know, really massive thanks for that, because they didn't have to let me use that. But it made so much sense in the shoot 'em up level, and it looks so cool when it flies in.
That shoot 'em up level, is that based on, is it Hate?
There was Viewpoint and Zaxxon were the two. The walls kind of remind me, I think it was Viewpoint. It was a Neo Geo game.
Ah, right. There's a game I have. There it is. A game by Gremlin called Hate, which
I remember that.
Was very similar, and I thought maybe it was based on that. Hostile all-terrain encounter.
It might have nicked the idea from the arcade. But there was a lot of the isometric ones. Zaxxon was probably the more famous one. And I did sort of style it to look a little bit like that. But I used to play quite a few of them. I remember the Neo Geo one. I swear it was Viewpoint. That was awesome. It looked fantastic. Our local chip shop had it.
Our local chip shops were the best places to play arcades.
Did you remember?
Golden Axe in the local chip shop near me was every time we went there, it's like...
No, all Double Dragon at the Working Man's Club.
Oh, Double Dragon coin-op was amazing. That was in a, I played that recently in a club in Southampton, randomly.
No way, that's my hometown.
Yeah. Cool. 30 seconds, last code's going to go in. So keep an eye out for yours.
Well done. Hope you enjoy it.
Yeah, so I think it's I think it's 5 o'clock now, so keeping you up past your bedtime. I will I'll wrap things up now, so let's chuck this code in anyway. I need to get to this. I just want to jump off this lift, get in this top door here. Do-do-do-do-do. Oh, one thing I did want to ask, actually, before we go, is there any chance at all of a Vita release?
Yeah, there is. The Vita's being worked on right now. The Vita's 2-3 weeks behind, basically. So it'll be Vita and Xbox One and the two missing platforms.
Awesome. I wonder if that'll be ready in time for E3. Maybe not. I need stuff to play on my Vita on the plane. I've just downloaded Downwell. I don't know if you've ever
heard of Downwell. Yeah, I'm going to get that.
Incredible game. With some cool ZX Spectrum style graphics.
Yeah. Definitely going to get that.
Yeah. Right, anyway. Were you going to say something?
No, I was going to say, hopefully. It's penciled for June, basically. Okay. It's really, really close.
All right, cool. So maybe, fingers crossed, I'll be able to play Lumo on the plane to LA. Are you gonna be in LA representing Lumo at all?
No, I'm hoping to be on holiday. Just need to support the game.
Fair enough. Well, you deserve a holiday after after giving birth to this wonderful game.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gareth, for joining us and talking us through a big chunk of Lumo and all its Easter eggs and secret references and things. It's been a pleasure having you on. Hope you've enjoyed yourself.
Yeah, it's been brilliant. Thanks very much. And I hope everyone enjoys Lumo. I've had a lot of fun making it, so it's really good fun talking about it.
Cool. Well, congratulations to everyone who's won the codes in the chat as well. It's 5 PS4 and 5 Steam codes that have gone out. The game is available to buy right now on the PlayStation 4 and Steam if you want it. And a couple of weeks or so until you can get it on the Xbox One and the PlayStation Vita. Thank you very much to everybody in the chat who's been watching and commenting. I hope you've enjoyed the stream as much as I have. Big thanks also to the moderators for keeping everything under control and banning all the nasty peeps. There wasn't very many. So, thanks again, Gareth. And,
cheers, mate.
I will hopefully be speaking to you again in the future for another AAA game.
Yeah, definitely.
Cool. Awesome. Thanks a lot.
Cheers.
I'll speak to you soon. Bye.
Bye.
Cool, everyone. Right, so awesome. That was legend that is Gareth Noyce. Hope you enjoyed the stream. I'm off now to go and have some dinner. So if you did win a copy of the game, do let Gareth know at Corruptor on Twitter if you got it. And do let him know if you enjoyed it. And don't forget to like this video and subscribe to Eurogamer for plenty more live streams and other cool video game content. In the near future, we've got Witcher review chat's gone up. The Witcher DLC video review chat has gone up. Loads of gameplay of the new Witcher DLC as Johnny talks about the Witcher with Aoife, I think. So do check that out if you like the Witchery stuff. And stick around for plenty more on Eurogamer. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.